peace. Peace. Peace to God. Hallelujah. It's a good day in the house of God. Both Florida Gators and FAU won yesterday. And so we're, thank you for cheering for that. I really appreciate that. Both of them beat their opponents. I'm pretty happy. I like when I've been praying for FAU football for a long time. And it sounds silly, but when FAU, I had covenanted in my heart that I was going to start praying for FAU football. I think I told you this. And they hired Lane Kiffin, which was their last coach, and they actually got the conference championship. And the next year, applications to FAU grew 25%. Amen. And so we're to pray for the peace of our city. Amen. And football sounds silly, but high school seniors are silly. And it's amazing how many high school seniors will pick a university based on a sports team. As dumb as that sounds, it is true. And when the university rises, the city rises, right? We want better, we want better candidates going to that university so they stay in our city and make our city more educated. You know, like, we want prosperity in our town. And I like winning, right? I like winning. And if you're a Christian, you're a bandwagon fan. You got on the winning team after it was already winning, right? That's who you are. You were on the losing team, and you said, let me just start rooting for the winner. That's a Christian. And so if your team is a loser and they're never going to win, pick a new team. You know how much more fun it is to watch your team win than lose? Hello. Root for winning teams. When you start winning, I'll root for you again. Until then, it's not going to be able to do it, right? Speaking of men things, we're going to go bowling tonight, men. We're going to do that, and we're going to throw balls at men and be men. I don't know what that has to do with being a man, but that's what we're going to go do. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. I was out of town. I was in Orlando. Thank you for keeping us covered in prayer. I was at a conference. That's all I'll say about that. I'm so happy to be home with you. Tell you that myself. Happy home with you. Happy home with you. I don't want to go. Amen. Happy to be home with you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. 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 So we're in our message series, The Go of the Gospel. And we all have heard the go of the gospel. We've all heard to go out and preach the gospel. And somehow we have perverted that in our head to go out and convince people to become Christians. And so when we think about preaching the gospel, many people don't want to do it because they think that somehow you have to prepare to win an argument. When that's not what Jesus said. Jesus said, go preach the gospel. Not go and make politicians bring rules that make us look Christian. He didn't say go and start businesses that have a fish on the side of your truck. Like, and those things are fine if they're done right, but that's not what Jesus commanded us to do. As a matter of fact, we can't pay somebody to do this for us. We can't elect somebody to do it for us. If you're a Christian, he has told you to go preach the gospel. But what we have found as we've gone through this gospel series, as we dig into the gospel, that most people don't actually know what the gospel is. Let me break it down for you. Gospel is a Greek word. Greek word of two words. It's news, and it's news that is good. The gospel is news that is good. The gospel is good news. And we, as Christians, have to be faithful to the gospel. Do you believe that the gospel is good news? If you don't, then you don't really know the gospel. Sometimes we're scared to tell someone the gospel because we think it might be bad news to them. If you have a concept of the gospel as bad news, then you do not know the gospel. Because the gospel is good news. It is news, and it is good. But I want to ask you today to ask yourself, is the gospel good news to me? Is it good news to me? been doing a deep dive in Dietrich Bonhoeffer, who's a theologian. I don't have time to get into why he's so relevant to today. He lived, he was actually martyred by the Nazis, but he wrote in one of his Christmas messages that he feared, and he lived in a Germany that was being overrun by Nazis, and he feared what he called a religionless Christianity, not using religion the way we would use religion, but he talked about he was fearful that we were inheriting a Christianity that had all the trappings of Christianity, but Christ wasn't actually in it. We would call it churchianity. You can lose Jesus in the churchianity. You can learn how to do the dance, or you can learn how to sing a song, or you learn how to be happy, or to say amen at the right time. You know how to start looking for your own sin. Somehow, maybe you're not focused all on church, but you're focused on your sin. And so Christianity becomes about your sin or your breakthrough. Sometimes we get so focused on our breakthrough that we forget about the God of the breakthrough. We get so focused on our blessing that we forget about the God who is the blessing. And so we talked about this religionless Christianity, and it's an absence of the presence of Christ crucified. It's an empty cross, but it's a cross that never had anybody on it. It's a Christianity that forgets about the third day resurrection and ascension of our Christ. It's religionless Christianity. And so I'm here today to convince you there is a difference between hearing the gospel and experiencing the gospel. There is a life where you have heard the gospel, but then there's a life that you have experienced the gospel, and then there is a life where you are experiencing the gospel. You're almost done saying that. I knew the gospel my whole life. How about you? This was not some sort of news to me in my mid-20s that this man Jesus had died on the cross for sin. It's not like I'd never heard that before. And by the time you got saved, it probably wasn't the first time that you had heard this news. But I had not experienced the gospel yet. Anybody know what I'm talking about? See, I had heard about the gospel, but then I met a man named Jesus. Then I met a man named Jesus who had actually been stretched out on that cross and pierced in his side and buried in a borrowed tomb. And on the third day, he was raised from the dead and then ascended to the right hand of the Father. And when I had experienced that gospel, then the gospel became alive on the inside of me. This is Christianity. It comes alive on the inside of you. And I don't just need to know the gospel. I need to live the gospel. But I don't only need to live the gospel. I need the gospel to live on the inside of me. Say that. This is what I am pressing on for. It is in this frame of understanding that we read Mark chapter 16, starting in verse 15. And Jesus said to them, "Go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation. He who has believed and has been baptized shall be saved, but he who has disbelieved shall be saved together, condemned. These signs will accompany those who have believed in my name, will cast out demons, speak with new tongues, pick up serpents, and if they drink any deadly poison, it will not hurt them. They will lay hands on the sick, and they will recover." And Father, we pray today, and we trust that you will bless the reading of your word. In the mighty name of Jesus, and all God's people said, amen and amen. Amen and amen and amen. And amen. And amen. Hallelujah. Something happens when the gospel comes alive on the inside of you. Say amen. I'm expecting the Holy Ghost to do something today. Something happens when the gospel comes alive on the inside of you. It's no longer I, but Christ who lives.
The life I live, it's dead. It's dead because of sin. But now, the life I live, I live Christ. There is a transformation that happens. The gospel, hear me, it is news. And it is good. It is news, and it is good. In Paul trying to explain to the church in Rome, he let them know that the gospel is the power of God for salvation. The good news. The fact that it is good news means that somebody has to say it. Somebody has to tell the news. The news has to be told, and the telling of this news that is good is the power of God for salvation. Somehow the gospel has to actually go forth. It has to be actuated. It has to be applied. It has to be delivered. It has to be disseminated. It has to be received. You have any idea what channel that is? I don't know what channel that is. Something's buzzed back there. It's the good news. Hallelujah. The gospel comes with a purpose. It comes with a mission. And there is a go of the gospel. Hear me, there is a go of the gospel. You cannot keep it to yourself. Once you have encountered the gospel, you cannot keep it to yourself. I'm going to try to be brief today because I've been preaching long. But wait, don't. Hallelujah. Hear me. Ha. When the gospel gets on you, it's finding another home. When the gospel gets on you and it gets active on the inside of you, it is looking for somewhere else to go. The gospel is more contagious than coronavirus. The gospel is more contagious than sin. The gospel is constantly, like there's only a few ways of transmission of coronavirus. You know, they put on the mask so it's not airborne, and you don't want to get it on your fingers so it gets somehow in your. But the gospel, if it can't find its way one way, it'll find another way. And if you block it one way, the gospel will come around the other way. And if you think you got to block the other way, the gospel will come up from the top. And if not, it'll come from the bottom. It'll visit you in your sleep when you think you're avoiding it. You'll run to the far corners of the earth, and there's the gospel waiting for you. Once the Holy Ghost has got a hold of you, the gospel is coming for you. The gospel is going forth. And as you know, you're just standing in line there at Publix, and someone just buying their little whatever, and you just feel the urge on the inside of you to talk to this person. And you just, that's what the gospel chasing them down. That's the gospel just going forth saying, I've decided I'm landing on this person. There's this doctrine called election, and some people use it as a division. Originally, when election was written by the Calvinists, the goal was to give God the glory for salvation. The goal was not to eliminate people from salvation. And so there's this doctrine of election, meaning God chooses to save some folk. Now, I just believe God has chosen to save all folk. However, I think if you are saved today, you can testify that there was a season that you couldn't get away from it. There was a season that the gospel was chasing you down. Maybe you grew up in the church and you got away, and then all of a sudden, the conviction, the Holy Ghost of God had decided, hey, it's their day again, and I'm just going to continue to hunt them down with the gospel till they decide to say yes and give their life to me because it's going to be better here anyways. And so sometimes these elected folk are just around you. And you're just like, I just got to say something. And you tell them the gospel and they don't say anything because they're running from it. That's God letting them know. You cannot get away from what I've called you to do. You just go talk to a sinner friend and they start quoting things God said to you. You're like, dang. Can't go nowhere. Why I got sinners prophesying to me? What kind of craziness is this? What is this all about? I drink myself to sleep, pass out, have a Holy Ghost dream. Feel like, Lord. Let me tell you, when the gospel's active, David recognized it. David was on the run, and he said, yet even if I go to hell, there you will be to find me. Like, I cannot get away from you. You are forever with me. The gospel's stickier than any pollen. It will just get on you. My dog, I walk the dog. We wash the dog. We walk the dog. We don't leave the sidewalk. We come home, and there's just stickers all over the dog. Like, how did this happen? They're like dog magnets, right? Like, they're just there, and they're in my bed, and like, how did you get in my bed? We pick the things off the dog, and here are the things. That's the gospel. You just all over your house. You just start getting reminders of God's goodness, and you just like, I can't get away from you. Something happens when the gospel comes to you. Remember Philip? Philip got affected with the gospel, and Philip was just minding his own business, and the Bible tells us in Acts chapter 8, he was just minding his own business, and some dude was reading the Bible and didn't know what was going on in the Bible. And the Holy Ghost had elected somebody, this eunuch from Ethiopia, right? Just traveling, just reading the Bible, doing his own thing. The Bible tells us in Acts chapter 8, verse 34, this eunuch says to Philip, please tell me, what does this say? Because Philip asks him, hey, man, I'm out here on my own, doing my own thing, and you're reading the Bible. Do you understand these scriptures? And he's like, you tell me, who does this talk about? He talks about himself or someone else? And then Philip, watch this, open his mouth. And beginning from this scripture, he preached, what did he do? Jesus to him. The gospel. He didn't tell the eunuch what he was doing wrong. He didn't tell the eunuch how he was supposed to worship. He didn't tell the eunuch what he was supposed to change. He didn't tell the eunuch why the eunuch was wrong and he was right. He preached Jesus to him. The man was reading Isaiah, but he didn't talk about Isaiah. He didn't talk about the Babylonian captivity. He didn't talk about how Moses had brought them out of the wilderness. He didn't talk about the prophets who had warned them about their sin, and their sin got them in captivity. And if only they had... No. Oh, you're reading about Isaiah? Well, let me tell you about Jesus. And so he preaches Jesus to him. I need y'all to get this. He preaches Jesus to the man, and then the man is like, wow, he's cut to the core. The Bible says he was convicted, and Philip taught him about baptism and salvation, and he's like, well, what stops me from getting water baptized right now? See, he preached Jesus, and then the man realized, I need to get right with God. When you preach the gospel, then the conviction comes. So many of us are out there trying to make people convicted and wondering why they're rejecting our message. Because our message is that God is good. And this is news to people. It's news that is good. God sent his son who died. And on the third day, he rose him from the dead. And he is now ascended at the right hand of the Father. And you have an advocate at the right hand of the Father. And if you believe in him, you will have everlasting life. That is news. That is good. And so this eunuch, in hearing the news that is good, then was convicted and said, what must I do? We keep getting it backwards. We so want people to act good. We don't tell them how to get the good inside them. We got too many people acting good who aren't actually good. I sometimes hear Christians witnessing. I'm like, please just stop. Please just. I feel like it would be pleasing to the Lord if you would just shut up. You are not helping. You are not helping. Bless your heart. I understand what you're trying to do, but just start a blog, right? Start a blog and argue with other bloggers. That's your mission field right there. Just argue with other Christians. You're not helping. The news is good. The news is not, it's not bad news. It's good news. It's very good news. And what happens is, people don't think other people deserve to be treated good. Because I've been a Christian so long, you shouldn't get it good. You deserve to be punished.
No, you deserve to be punished for not realizing the news is good. It's good news. And you know what it's most good for? People you don't like. It's the best news for people you don't like. Don't be surprised, those people you think who don't deserve salvation, God will send you to them. And you say, okay, I'm here to judge them. He's like, no, you're going to love on them. That's the whole story of Jonah right there. I can't go to Nineveh. I'll look like an idiot. I'll tell them God's judgment's coming, and then they'll repent, and no judgment will come. I'll look like a moron. God's like, yep, that's exactly what's going to happen. I don't want to do that. Out of the belly of the beast, it's up to you, man. So he goes, tells them the word of the Lord, they all repent. Now, no judgment comes. That's the job. That's the payoff. They don't get the punishment they deserve. But too many Christians, we want to be on the in. We want to be the ones who aren't getting. We want to be the in, and we need those who are on the out. The people you think are on the out are the people God is calling you to. You think about them enough, you might as well tell them the gospel. We're in this political season, and I would just gently say, is your political philosophy making you love people better? Or do you somehow think it's okay to call people names in violation of the gospel of God? If it's causing you to insult people, you have believed a false gospel. And I would bid you, return to the gospel. It is good news. If you think someone who is a proponent of a wicked, wicked law, you are somehow relieved from loving them, you have not heard the good news. The news is good that you are not the judge of them. God is. All you get to do is tell him how good they are. That is your role as a Christian. And you don't stop being, well, maybe you do. We are not supposed to stop being a Christian because we've become a Democrat or a Republican. Now, you may. I would advise against it. I would advise you to stay a Christian, no matter how you vote, and love people well. That's what's going to change our world. You say amen. And let me tell you this. So many Christians that I meet who have passionate feelings about certain things, they're not moving forward in their Christianity. They're not graduating from the situation they're in. The burden that they're in is not lifted. And is it possible that they're stuck where you are at because you have not completed your assignment of love toward those you are called to? You are stuck in a cycle of hate and judgment and bitterness, and you have not been promoted to where God has you because you have not graduated to loving those who God has called you to love. You have not preached the gospel to those he has sent you to preach the gospel to. Is it possible those people that you are obsessed with in your mind with hating, he has called you to love them well, and you have not graduated into your calling because you've not preached the actual gospel to them? You have sat in the seat of judgment instead of the seat of mercy, bringing the good news to those who are far from God. Okay, I'm just preaching the Bible here. Watch this. Philip saw this eunuch. Now, a eunuch is a sexual minority. Can you hear me? We need. I believe I'm not ashamed to tell you I have a traditional sexual ethic. I believe the scripture shows that, and I can unpack that more later. I don't hate anybody, but we do have a Messiah who is single. Right? If your view of love fulfillment has to do with marriage, I would say there is a deeper love that we can learn from Jesus. We worship a Messiah who chose celibacy. That means something. If you desire a mate, I pray you receive one. Don't. But of his friend group, we know that he lived with a very unique group of friends. We know that there was Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. All lived together. All were single. Interesting friend group. We have a Messiah who chose celibacy with three best friends who were single. There's something to be understood about this. But here we got this eunuch. We don't know why they're a eunuch. We don't know if this was as part of the court he was surgically become a eunuch. Or we don't know exactly. But we know that Philip saw this man passing by and did not refuse him the gospel. And he didn't change the gospel. He didn't tailor the gospel. He told the man about Jesus. And then he water baptized him. After he loved this man well with the gospel, what happened? Verse 39. When they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord snatched Philip away, and the eunuch no longer saw him, but he went on his way rejoicing. Now, I feel like there are people who are called to a people group, and you are fighting the call to minister the gospel, so you have not been snatched away to your next assignment yet. You want God to catch you up to the new thing, but God is not going to release you of this assignment till you preach the gospel in this season. You can't just drop one thing and be like, God gave you an assignment. You're like, I'm not so sure about that one. You got anything else, God? You got any other assignments out there I can have instead? Can I look through your files and see which job I might want to fulfill? God's like, you don't got the assignment. You failed the test. I get it. I'm a gracious God. You can take the test again. You're like, but I'm not liking this one. Can I take another course? Absolutely. Just finish this test, and then you can take another course. All right, but I actually went to the registrar, and I dropped this course. God's like, I'm the registrar, and you built your own little educational system that I don't actually honor. Those credits don't transfer here. You have to finish this class to go on to the next one. You're like, well, I'll just start taking another class. I was like, go ahead. You come back with your report card. God, look how good I'm doing over here. He's like, that's great. You got this test over here. You still haven't passed. Come over and pass this test, and you get caught up like Philip into your new assignment. Come on, I believe God wants to catch some of you up into a new assignment. I believe it's a time for a new, greater assignment, but we gotta clean up some loose ends from the last season, some things that we left out there that God needs wants you to clean up. Oh, I can just leave a mess back there, and God will just promote me. No. That was sin. You need to clean that up. People are going to move on to their new assignment until they clean up that last site, that last season. God is not mocked. God just caused chaos over here, and then you go on, and God will bless you. Watch out. It'll be there. It will be there waiting for you. Amen. The gospel is news, and it is good. The gospel is news, and it is good. I've been reading Judges. And Judges, and if you've read Judges, you get this. If you haven't, at some point read Judges. It can be a little, like, if we could be honest, Judges gets a little frustrating to read because you see this cycle in Israel, and they good time back there. Go ahead. Come on. It's a dinosaur. Got it. So there's this cycle in Judges where like, there's sin, and the Bible tells like there's no king in the land, and everybody falls after their own ways. And then God lifts up a judge, and the judge rules over the land, and then righteousness comes, and blessing comes, and then there's another generation, and they kind of turn away again, right? And then they fall into sin, and then they fall into curse, and then there's destruction and plague, and then judges sent, and then they turn back to God, and you read this cycle. Anybody know what I'm talking about? You read this cycle over and over and over again, and it's more than just a cycle of sin. It's almost a cycle of addiction. If you've ever known anyone or you've ever dealt with addiction, there's like these cycles that you go through, like this onsetting sin that does this besetting sin that you never get free of. Like you're free and you're good, and you're on top of the world, and you don't worry about it, and then out of nowhere, you just open a room, and there it is, it slaps you in the face, and you fall into this season of sin again, right? And you just wait for it, and you just try to struggle with it, then you kind of give in to it, and then you get tired of it, and then you come out of it. It's a cycle, you know what I'm talking about? And so you read this book of Judges, and God again and again brings a judge as a deliverer, and he delivers them out of this sin. And God says, hey, you got to be good. And they're like, yeah, we'll be good. And then the cycle starts again. And Judges ends kind of disappointing because they never actually break the cycle, right? They never actually get free. But near the end, it says again that no one did what was right in the sight of the Lord, and everybody did what was right in their own eyes. And near the end of Judges, there's this really kind of funny story about a man named Micah. And Micah, I believe it's Micah 17. Judges 17. Micah shows up on the scene, and Micah sees right after Samson was the judge. And Samson did all these amazing things, but then again, he fell, and again, here we are. And Micah decides, I'm going to take my chips, and I'm going to go and play my own game. I'm going to take my ball and go home. Right? I don't need any of this anymore. And the Bible says he gets 100 pieces of silver, and he decides he's going to create his own temple. And so in the same pattern of the temple in Jerusalem, he makes an altar with 100 pieces of silver. He makes the things, and he finds a Levite who was born in Bethlehem, and he says, hey, I'll hire you to be my priest. And he hires this guy to come in and to be his priest in his own little thing that he made on his own, in his own little temple. And in Judges 17:3, here's what he says. Micah said, now I know that the Lord will prosper me, seeing I have a Levite as a priest. And I'll tell you what, if that ain't the church in America today, like, I'll just go do my own thing. I don't actually need to be part of the church. I am the church. Me and the Bible, we are the church. And this guy, completely against all the laws surrounding worship, against all the laws surrounding sacrifice, against all the rules the scriptures clearly spelled out about not appointing your own priests, about not lifting up those who are not assigned to this role, how the lineage had been set aside for the priesthood, how it was very clear that they're not supposed to make any engraved image. I mean, like, I have something that looks like it. Now God will bless me, right? Now God will go ahead and bless me in my eyes. The problem is you can't just start your own church because you didn't like the leaders of the one you left. I'll just do my own thing. And God's like, no, you had an assignment. You had an assignment. This doesn't, you can't hire your own priest. It doesn't work that way. Again, Judges 17:6, in those days there was no king in Israel. Every man did what was right in his own sight. And time and again, God would raise up prophets to speak against this very pattern. In Isaiah 46, he says, those who lavish gold from the purse and weigh silver on the scale, hire a goldsmith and makes it into a god. They bow down, indeed they worship it. They lift it upon the shoulder and carry it. They set it in place and stands there. It does not move from its place. Though one may cry to it, it cannot answer. It cannot deliver him from his distress. They thought, hey, I will make my own religion. We won't have any of these problems. God is like, this thing that you're making on your own call, your own destiny, your own God, it cannot deliver you like the gospel. Jeremiah prophesied the same. Beaten silver is bought from Tarsus and gold from Uphaz. The work of a craftsman in the hands of a goldsmith. Violet and purple are their clothing. They all are all work of skilled men, but the Lord is the true God. He is the living God and the everlasting King. At his wrath, the earth quakes, and the nations cannot endure his indignation. God is like, you don't just get blessings without my correction. You don't get me without my church. You don't get my blessings without my law. You don't get my gentle comfort and love without my loving correction. You don't get the gospel that comes to you and changes your life and brings you into joy without my Holy Spirit that says I am going to convict the world of righteousness, sin, and judgment. We can't play Bible hopscotch, picking the parts we like and leaving out the parts we don't like. We got to receive the gospel for all its worth, that the news of God's sacrifice is good. His salvation is good. The devil is bad. He is working for those and through those who deny the gospel, who would bastardize the truth, who would pervert the word of God, who prey upon those who are seeking a true shepherd. The good news is so good because the bad news is so bad. And we live in a day and age where each one, there is no king in the land, and people are doing what is right in their own sight, refusing to receive the wisdom and counsel of elders. Can you say amen? But God has a better way. God has a better way, amen. God has a better way. When the gospel comes, it challenges our priorities. When the gospel comes, it challenges our priorities. I don't know about you, Duke, but when I got saved, my life changed. Brent, when I received the gospel, the strata of priorities in my life was all of a sudden different. Amen. I had some authorities in my life that I did not have before. Authorities like Isaiah and Matthew, my pastor and the man discipling me. I had some authorities in my life that were telling me, hey, good idea, wrong God. Not all knowledge is good knowledge. Not everything that sounds wise is wisdom. Amen. Amen. Come on. Yeah, yeah, yeah. The world has wisdom that will not get you the peace of God. The world has wisdom that will not get you the peace of God. Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. So, Paul, this brilliant apostle, wise and patient. He writes his letter to the church of Corinth, and I tell you to hear. It's painful to hear people teach the Bible who don't understand the Bible. I'll leave it at that. My wife is coiling a little bit. It wasn't too long ago we were sitting in meetings. Can I just tell you how petty I am? I'm petty, right? Oh, yeah, I'm petty, right? I'm petty. P, right? Petty. We got this thing. Now, if you've ever done public speaking, you're going to say something wrong, right? You're going to mean one thing and not. And, you know, I was listening to a theologian talk recently, and he was quoting scripture like beautifully, but he kept saying the wrong book, right? And I knew that he knew, because he had the scriptures memorized, right? And he was saying one book, but he meant the other book. And I'm like, it was irritating me a little bit, but I was giving grace, because you know sometimes you just do that. Does that make sense? Like you just do that. But like we were at a thing one time, and I really shouldn't have gone down this road. Not only were they teaching the Bible completely out of context, but they were spelling things wrong on the overhead. And I'm just like, wrong there, you know? And there should be an apostrophe. It's not plural. And I'm like, did you spell that kind of weather with no H? He's like, no. I'm like, oh, Jesus, help me. Yeah, I'm petty, right? Oh, Jesus, help me. The gospel is good news. And I kept telling myself, just preach the gospel. Just preach the gospel. Just preach the gospel. Okay, the church in Corinth. As you read the New Testament, as you read the writings of Paul, it's super important that Paul, more than anything else, his goal was unity in the church. Like, his goal was unity in the church. In a good portion of his epistles, the goal was unity. And sometimes he took a very long time in laying out the case for unity. And people will pick little sentences here and there to make whole other doctrines, where Paul was trying to tell people, like, you're not better than anybody else. Unity. You need these other people. You are not the whole body of Christ yourself.
So we see in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, which I have preached about a zillion times, right? He talks about the gifts of the Spirit. The goal was not to enumerate the Spirit. The goal was to say there's one Spirit but different administrations. That's the goal of that, right? And then he gives 1 Corinthians 13 saying, man, I need you to know this. If you're going to operate in the Spirit, he's about love, right? So you can't say you're operating in the Spirit in one of these gifts and you're above loving people. Like, love is kind of an important deal here since God is love, right? And then 1 Corinthians 14, he kind of goes through these gifts again, trying to say, hey, I need y'all to see that y'all can be different, but you need each other. There's one, right? Why did he write all this? He wrote this because these people were so focused on their ministry, their gifts, what they thought was important. They were dividing the church. They were saying, oh, I'm this person. I have that gift. I have this calling. I'm better than that. And here's what Paul says to them. I like it in the NIV the best. He gets to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. He says, now, brothers, I want to remind you of the gospel that I preach to you. You're so caught up in these gifts, you have completely abandoned the gospel. Paul had to say to the church in Corinth, he got prophets, apostles, evangelists, pastors, teachers, miracles, gifts of tongues and interpretation, wisdom and revelation. You have all these gifts, but now I have to remind you of the gospel, the whole point of the church. You've completely forgotten what this thing is about. I want to remind you of the gospel that I preached to you. Now, I didn't preach to you prophecy. I didn't preach to you tongues and interpretation. I didn't preach to you healing. I preached to you gospel. And Paul had to actually spell it out in the letter. I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you, which you received and which you have taken your stand. By this gospel you are saved if you hold firmly to the word I preached you. Now he's saying, y'all are so far off, I'm not even sure you're saved. You're so convinced on what you want to have happen, I'm not even sure you're Christians anymore. Your little pet ministry is so important, I got to preach the gospel to you again to get you back to Jesus. Amen. I have seen this. I have fallen prey to this myself in early years, that I thought healing was so important that all of a sudden we forget about the healer, that a prophecy is so important that we forget the last great prophet, Jesus, right? We forget that Jesus is the voice of God, and we somehow think, no, it's about him, right? We're so focused on these gifts that we forget, I got to bring you back to the gospel. So focused on community that we feel like, if this community ain't under the gospel, it ain't community. It is a club. It ain't nothing but a concert. And it is not going to heaven. I got to bring you back to the gospel. And Paul goes on. He's like, let me tell you this. I have dealt with this demon more than once. I have dealt with this Spirit that wants the church to be about them. First handful of years of this church, like someone found out a spirit-filled church was in town, they're like, oh, I can go do my ministry there. And I would be ministering in the front, and they would be ministering in the back, and I would shut things down with a quickness. We are not playing that game. That is not the gospel. I've dealt with this demon so many times. The cure to that self-pity demon is to start talking about the gospel. To start talking about Jesus. People come up to me, oh, I want you to know that I'm a prophet. I'm like, well, I've got to go to a church that never sees me that way. I've had these conversations. I just want to let you know that I'm an apostle. This person in 1972 laid hands on me. I'm like, well, you might want to go to their church. Because right here, you're going to be a guy sitting listening to the gospel. That's the position we have available for you right now. We could use some help setting up signs. And so if you're an apostle, you believe in signs and wonders. So if you'll show up early, set up some signs, and it'll be a wonder that you actually serve the church and return to the gospel. We had all these church people that thought whatever they were mad about their old church, they could do here. And so we were just starting
And we're trying to get things off the ground. We're preaching the gospel, seeing people get saved, and people started getting out of our church. They're like, "Yeah, Pastor, we're planning a getaway." I'm like, "Who's we? Where are we getting away to?" And they're like, "Yeah, no, we're planning a camping trip." I'm like, "For who? For the church?" I'm like, "We ain't going camping. This ain't about a camping trip. What are you talking about camping trip?" Well, first of all, I got a comfortable bed, right? And I like air conditioning. Okay, I'm an Eagle Scout. I'm done sleeping on the ground forever. I'm done, right? It's like, I'm like, where in this do people get saved? Where's Jesus? Oh no, you don't understand. You need community. You need us. Like, are any of these people saved that you're talking about? Let's get them saved and then we'll talk about it. I'm like, no, but nice knowing you. I knew they were leaving. Because a church, it's a beautiful community. I mean, it's precious. God loves it when it's founded on the gospel. When the community is there to put forth the gospel, to apply the gospel to people's lives, the death, the burial, the resurrection, and the ascension of Jesus. And there's a lot of communities that don't mind that whole death and burial, resurrection, but the fact that now Jesus is Lord and you are not. That is the gospel. That is the God. That is what saves souls. Come on, somebody. That is what changes communities. When we pray, "Not my will, but your will be done." When we pray, "Your kingdom come on earth," that means that you rule and you reign on the earth. And we all submit to your gospel on the earth. Hallelujah. I feel good right now. Listen, you want to keep yourself out of the pit? Talk about Jesus. Get out of that pit of your little ministry. Become the most important thing. I'm trying to stay focused really hard right now. Verse 3. Watch this. Here's what Paul says. He says, here's what Paul says. All these problems about gifts. And we've been in, come on, Christopher, we've been in some circles that gifts get more important than Jesus. Amen. Amen. How does Paul deal with this? "For what I received, I passed on to you first importance," which watch, he starts preaching. "That Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried and raised on the third day according to Scriptures, and that he appeared to Peter and then to the 12, and then he ministered and he ascended to the right hand of the Father." Paul is like, "I'm going to get y'all back. I'm going to get y'all back to something that is fruitful, that will not implode upon itself in a cloud of dust." We got a lot of crazy church happening today. You don't even have to be online for an hour before you run across somebody deconstructing something. They think they're deconstructing Christianity. They're deconstructing unhealthy church. Church that isn't based on the gospel. Man-centered church. Feeling-centered church. Me-centered church. And the me could be the leader. The me could be you. The not Christ is King-centered church. And what we find out is, like, you know, one time, my wife for years, she wanted to do a couples massage. For a long time, she wanted to do a couple. Now, I got a problem with couples massage. Now, I have grace on your pastor as I tell you the story, right? I've been married for a long time, right? I don't want men touching me, right? I just don't want. I've been married a long time, you know. I don't think I'm a homophobe or anything. I just don't want men touching me. I don't really like it. And so, I'm married. I'm pretty happy with the wife I have. I don't want women touching me. I don't want women touching my body. And I don't really want a man touching my body. So this has been kind of a stumbling block, as it were. Right? But we went on a vacation one time. We went to Panama. Went to Panama City, Panama as a vacation. And they had a spa in the hotel. And she booked a couple of massages. And she decided, you know, what kind? Now, they didn't speak hardly any English, right? And my wife is pretty good with Spanish, but I don't think she's ever ordered a massage in Spanish. You know what I'm saying? Like you got your lane, you know, of your Espanol, you know, but you may not have the full breadth of it. You know what I mean? Like, I can order food. I can cast out demons in Spanish, right? I can tell people to applaud for Christ. But beyond that, it's very limited. So my wife is talking with people, and unbeknownst to me, she didn't order the deep tissue massage. Now, I don't know if you know this, but deep tissue massage is like code word for like jujitsu on your body
and you don't fight back for an hour. That's what deep tissue massage is. I don't know what she was doing. I swear she might have had a bat. I don't know. I think I heard some chains coming out the closet that she was swinging on me. I was rising. I was ready to fight back. And mama, if she hits me like that one more time, it's on. Right? Like, it's on like Donkey Kong. Like, we're going, like, I can only allow this for so long. Good thing it's not a man because, you know, I'd be throwing these hands right here. And so she is beating me down for like, I'm like, and I'm just like submitting to God, Lord. I just submit to your reproof. God, I'm just going to believe that this is an agent of Satan to buffer my body, Lord, that you are sifting me for a greater glory, right? And we got done, and I was like, the hell was that, honey? My wife's crying in the table, man. I'm like, what was that? I woke up the next day. I swear, I felt like I had been in a gang fight. I was on the wrong end of a beatdown. I was like, oh, Jesus, my back. My neck and my back. Oh, Jesus. Why do we, and we paid somebody hundreds of dollars to do this. I could have just roamed around on Tamron Avenue with a fitty hanging out my pocket and got that for free. There are many ways to catch a beatdown that would not have cost that much money. I was like, what have you done to me? And why did you possibly think I would enjoy this? He's like, that's not what I meant. I never received anything like that in my life. I tell you what. Like, I was like, you put your elbow there again, lady. It's on. Sweet Jesus. Stop it. Oh, God. It's always like, hey, we can go to a real couple's massage. I'm like, that's it. It's one and done, baby. That was it. She's like, no, this is supposed to be relaxing. I'm like, you got me beat up. If you're mad at me, just tell me. If I done violated our marriage, just let me know. I don't need this. But that's the last massage Pastor Carl's ever getting. That's it. I'm done. Right? I'm done. And my wife is like, that's not a real massage, right? But we see today people are like, oh, the church is corrupt. They do this. I'm like, I never experienced that. They did this to me. They like, I ain't. You sound like you signed up for that deep tissue massage. You are at the wrong church. There's people out there, they're scared to even read the Bible because of so much condemnation that has been read into it over them. So much spiritual abuse. So much manipulation. And someone's got their feelings hurt, and the pastor actually corrected them, and they like, ever since then, they got this thing against Jesus. This is the world we're dealing with. They don't got a bad translation of the massage. Does that make sense? They don't got a bad translation. So we're not just going out into a world that knows the gospel. We know we're in a world here that has filtered the gospel through their experience. And you, if you are not careful, you will get caught up in trying to defend or condemn what they went through. Watch this. This is what the devil will do. Based on their hurt, he will deviate you from the gospel. Oh, but God is really love, and he's really good to you, and everything's going to be good. Maybe. I mean, he is love, and he is good. It may not look anything like you want. The truth of the matter is, you will go through hard seasons with Christ because you got to learn how to be faithful. And the Bible tells us that hard times come so we can learn how to endure. The Bible says that he will send people to correct us. We are to submit to godly authority so that we can grow in Christ. But our society has taught us if someone tells us something we don't like, it's my feelings that are more important, and I get to do whatever. And that is not the gospel. So when you preach a perverted gospel that God just all he like he just wants you to be happy, and he wants to, I heard a message. I gotta stop preaching bad messages too. I heard a message the other day from a guy I used to follow, and he said, if you want to know what your call is, figure out what you really love and what you're passionate about. That's what God wants to fill in your life. I was like, that is a bag of lies right there. Where does someone love pornography? God will make you a Holy Ghost pornographer. Oh, hallelujah. I can see it now. Pornography for Jesus. It's all sanctified. Jesus, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Selfish church, right? Like, I've seen every other name of a church, selfish church. It's all about you. You all get your own headsets, right? You show up to the church, you know, like, there's the Spanish headsets, there's the Portuguese headset, there's the prosperity headsets. There's a you-can-do-whatever-you-want headset, there's a selfish headset, and you have some pastor in the back will hear what the pastor's speaking and, you know, make sure we won't say anything that won't get you upset. Just, oh, you know, it'll all be catered right to what you want to hear, right? You know? It's you, church. You, church. And so can Jesus, church. I'm almost done. I'm on a roll here, but I'm almost done. I have a leaders meeting. I don't know what was said, but I believe it. I have a leaders meeting after service, and I'm gonna tell you part of what I'm gonna tell them. I have talked to the Lord, and I meet with pastors, and they're like, you know, you really got to come up with a vision statement and that mission statement. You got to get the vision statement. I'm like, vision. With Jesus, he's like, I'm gonna give y'all a vision statement right in the Bible. There's a church 20 feet that way. They got the same mission statement we do. And they speak a different language. There's churches all over Boca. Every church don't need its own vision unless it's got its own God. There is one mission for the church. We are to be the hands and feet of Christ. We are to preach the gospel to all creation, to baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, to disciple them in the Word of God. This is the vision of the church. This is the mission statement of the church. The problem is somehow the church has adopted American Christianity, American prosperity, American globalism, American economic ideas, and think that we need to run the church like a business. And that ain't what Jesus came for. We got a vision statement. It came from our visionary, Jesus. And he sent it in the book that was sent for us because we're too stupid to just follow what he tells us. He's like, do I have to write this down to you? And you know what the answer was? Yes. Yes, yes, I have to write it down to you. So he writes it down for us. We have a vision statement. We have a mission statement. It's Jesus. Amen. And I want to end with this encouragement. Come on up, Stanley, again. I want to end with this encouragement, because this is about the goal of the gospel. The gospel cannot be stationary. What we see in Jesus has been shown so many times in the Old Testament, in types and shadows. And Moses, of course, was a type and shadow of a deliverer, which Jesus is. And Moses was called by God to serve as this instrument to deliver the Israelites from Egyptian slavery. And as the story goes, Egypt was a massive country, and slavery was a massive part of their economy. And as God calls Moses to be this deliverer, Moses keeps coming up with excuses why he can't deliver God's message to Pharaoh. And at each time Moses tells God why he can't do it, God keeps promising, go, I will help you speak. I'll teach you what to say. Go. I'll help you speak. I'll tell you what to say. He says it over and over again. I'll help you. I'll teach you. And these promises are rooted in the promises in Exodus 3:12, that I will be with you. Jesus came and promised that same thing that Moses, that special thing that Moses had, is going to be every Christian's testimony. Lo, I will be with you even to the end of the age. He sent his Spirit, and the Spirit of Christ dwells in us. I will teach you. I will tell you what to say based on I will be with you. Today I want to challenge you to move into the call of God on your life. To be bold and speak about Jesus. You do not need to argue with people. You don't have to defend God. You don't have to clean up whatever happened at their old church.
You do not have to be their therapist and their pastor and their counselor and their prophet. You just tell them about Jesus. When I was away from God, my story is God had me at a really low place financially. And I was seeking God. I knew He was calling me. And I just moved to Gainesville, where I did not want to be. And I was staying with a friend until I could find somewhere to live. And he was kind of he grew up very Christian, but he wasn't that bright, if I can say it that way. And he had a faith in God, but he wasn't that bright. And so he was talking about God one day, kind of arrogantly. And I considered myself a Christian, even though I wouldn't say it. Didn't have to say it. And I said, "Well, Danny, let me ask you this." And he's the best man in my way. Mark's the best man in my way. And I said, "Danny, let me ask you this. If two Christian teams are playing each other, and they're both praying to God, how does he pick one? Whose prayers work?" Which I think is pretty cool for a non-believer. And Danny said to me, "God wants all his children to do well." And that just sounds like a... But that answer is smarter than Danny could come up with. And that answer pierced my heart. Because I'm coming with some logical debate. And Danny's just talking about Jesus. That thing pierced my heart. I was like, I had let him know how dumb he was many times, right? That's this time I couldn't talk. Like, that was it. I was like, oh. Then God go to sleep now. Within a couple of weeks, I got baptized in the Holy Ghost, and here I am, right? Amen. Thank you, Danny. Thank you, Danny. Let's talk about Jesus. Oh, but how do I get him? Let's talk about Jesus. Bring him to a place where the gospel is preached. They can learn how to serve God. Somebody in their life can disciple them. You've been saved for a couple minutes. Find somebody you can pour into. Find somebody that you can be that person you wish you had in life. Because as you tell that person about Jesus, the gospel comes alive on the inside of you. I'm going to close with this. Is the gospel still news to you? Is it something you think you already know? Is it still news? Is it still bringing goodness? You can get the lights for me. Is the gospel today? Been there, done that. I've heard it. It's old. I'm ready to move on to something else. Or is it still news to you? My heart gets the other one. Thank you. Or both. Or one. So many options. So many options. Bring that down. Bring that down very low. Very low. We'll try next week. When we go live, man, it's going to be amazing. When we start learning, when we decide we're going to do that emotional manipulation, we have all this dialed in. When this church becomes about that emotional, smoke would have come out just then, like, it's going to be awesome. He's like, is that the glory? Could be. Or hey, you know. Hear me. Is the gospel still news to you? I am actually done, but I'm going to tell you another story. want to land with this. You're in a prophetic church. You're a prophetic pastor. I live a prophetic life. Prophetic things will happen to you, happen to me. When I know God is talking to me, I start seeing patterns. When I start seeing them happen 2, 3, 4 times, then I know. And we've seen a pattern, my wife and I, of older people who have been saved for a long time and aren't happy in the church. The church changes or has no focus or doesn't have people their age. And we used to be like, well, I understand, I get it. And then after like the third time, like a Holy Ghost irritation started to get on me. And I was like, Lord, I don't want to judge these people. I can't be mad at somebody because they want to be around people their age. And so my wife and I, we continue to pray into it. Finally, the last time someone came to us, they're like, we're like, how long have you been saved? 50 years. Are you discipling anybody? Is it possible God has you in a church of younger people? Because you're supposed to graduate to do something. Sweet Jesus, do you still need to be spoon-fed every Sunday morning? Because I know you're coming to me like you're a mature Christian, but you haven't matured to the role of elder. Where you're actually teaching people the gospel. So if you've been saved for a minute, it's time to find somebody to teach the gospel to. It's time to find somebody who's been saved half the time you've been saved. If you've been saved for 5 years, find somebody who's been saved 2 years or less. If you've been saved for a month, find somebody who ain't saved yet, right? You've been saved for a week. Start going through the Bible with them. Come on. A couple steps ahead of them, but you know, someone where you can say, listen, I know you want to run. God has actually got this. Like, I've been through that. God's like, I ain't got it all right, but God has got this. Like, the problem that we move on from the good news and get distracted by the community or distracted by gifts or distracted by all this other stuff, and I believe in all those things more than ever. You know me, I'm into the weird stuff even. Like I'm into all of it. But if it's not based in the gospel, then we just started a new religion. I'm not interested in that. Because that is like what Jeremiah talked about. They're made of hands and they do not bring peace. I met someone not too long ago. They said, hey, I just want to tell you about a ministry. Give us a book about deliverance. I'm like, no, I'm good. Thanks. Ministry based on demons is not something I want to be a part of. I'm good. I met Jesus. I'm good. If it was a day and age, I would have been excited about that. But the gospel is good news. And I want it to be news to you. Stand with me. I want it to be news to you, and I want it to be good. And so here's what Jesus said at the end of, quoted at the end of Mark about Jesus. He said to them, go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation. I've been to my house, I got a big row of bushes in the back. They were very small plants when I planted them because I'm cheap. And I didn't want to buy big ones. So I bought little ones. And I would water them and I would preach to them. I would prophesy over my plants. You are going to grow strong and large. You're going to withstand hurricanes and you're going to be like a wall in my backyard, right? And I'm not saying that made it, but it is. They're there now. People are like, that's amazing. How much did that cost? Not as much as you would think. But it did cost the blood of Jesus, right? Because I was speaking the gospel to all creation. Listen, go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation. He who has believed and has been baptized shall be saved. He who has disbelieved shall be condemned. These signs will accompany those who have believed in my name. They'll cast out demons. They'll speak in new tongues. They'll pick up serpents. And if they drink any deadly poison, it will not hurt them. Meaning, I will be with you. I will be with you. They will lay hands on the sick, and they will recover. Meaning, I, the power of Yahweh, the power of I am, by you speaking, will be there, healing the sick, setting captives free, speaking a better future into their lives. Can you say amen? Come on, let's pray in the Spirit for a second. I believe God wants to activate a couple people. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, Father, I pray. I pray right now in the mighty name. I pray in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Father God, in the name of Jesus. Father God, in the... Here we go. Come on, somebody's got a testimony in this room that the world needs to hear. Somebody's got a breakthrough. You may not be all the way there yet, but you've been down a road that the world needs to hear about. The devil got you thinking that if people find out about who you were, they're going to look at you some type of way. But God says, if you will share what I did in your life, your assignment will be completed and I can move you on. I can move to your promotion. I can move to your next assignment. I believe God is going to unstuck some people under the sound of my voice as they recommit their lives to the gospel. As they recommit their lives to the gospel, they'll receive that thing that they've been praying for. They'll receive that breakthrough they've been contending for. They'll receive that blessing that they've been believing for in the name of Jesus. I believe if you will recommit yourself to Christ and her church and the going forth of the gospel of Jesus Christ, these distractions will be broken in your life and you'll move into the promise God has for you in the name of Jesus. Go on, somebody. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody, and thank the Lord. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. It's a new day. It's a new day. It's a new day. Can you sing that chorus, No Shadow? Or whatever, however it starts.
Are you watered out, coming after me?
One more time.
No shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. No wall you won't get down, now you watered out, coming after me.
Now I want you to think about this song a different way. No shadow I won't light. You are the one in darkness that he lit up. And there's someone out there he's coming after. Come on, somebody. There's a mountain that you set between you and God. And God done moved that mountain so you could get saved. And he's coming after somebody with the mountain he overcame in your life. With the shadow that he lit up in your life. He don't save you for a reason. It wasn't just for your comfort. It wasn't just for your peace. Now we're going to sing about that person that you're called to, that assignment God has given you. We're going to sing this again, and we're going to feel God's heart for the lost, the goal of the gospel. Come on, Sam, do that.
Oh, don't say you won't light up, bow to you won't climb up.
Over your family right now. Sing it over your family right now. Sing it over your lost ones. Sing it over your... Come on. Sing it over your lost family right now. Come on. You're going to get them, Lord.
No wall you won't kick down. Tie you won't tear down. Come in that. Don't tear down.
Come on. Save them, Lord.
Shatter you won't kick down. Bounty you won't claim up.
earlier in this church, there was a girl who showed up, end of a message like this. I had an altar call. She came and got radically saved. I cast this devil out of her. Crying. It happened so many times in this church. She was close to moving. And before she moved, she said a guy had invited her to church every day at school. He gave her one of these little invitation cards. Every day he invited her to church. And she was getting ready to move, and she was in deep, deep depression, and had struggled with suicide. If you've ever been in that deep, dark place, you know what that's like. And she constantly contemplated ending her life. And that day, she came forward and got saved and got the devil cast out of her. And she came to me after services. It brings a tear to my heart just thinking about it. She said, I was getting ready to leave, and I looked at my backpack, and the bottom of my backpack was filled with these invitation cards. I said, well, before I go, she meant that physically and metaphorically, I guess I'll give this a try. And God set her free. Tell me God won't go running after people through you. Go on, give a praise. Tell me God won't seek and save those who are lost. Tell me He can't do it in your family. Tell me He can't do it in your workplace. Tell me He can't do it at IHOP. Tell me He can't do it in Boca Raton, where people think they're too rich for God. And He's going to do it through you. He'll give you words, and He will be with you. Receive this as I bless you. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift His countenance on you and give you peace. In the name of Jesus. Give a clap offering to the Lord. Listen, I know there's probably people in this room you need to give your life to Jesus. If that's you, I want you to come forward. Duke will be right here to pray for you. If you need healing in your body, we'd like to pray for you. God bless you. I look forward to seeing you. Amen. Give it up one more time for God. You can pick up invitation cards in the lobby. Thank you for coming.